Good morning, everybody.
Hello, instructional design fanatics, coffee fanatics, tea drinkers, soda pop drinkers, anything that can entertain the mind.
I think there's a lot of hot tea drinkers out there this morning, if I remember correctly.
Yep. It's a wide range of tastes, a wide range of preferences. As long as it brings you comfort, it's all welcome.
Indeed. Speaking of comfort, how's that weather in all of those places coming up in the chat? Look at that. We got Wyoming. We got Seattle. We've got, where else? Tennessee.
Seems like it's hot in a lot of places, including the UK today. I saw someone mentioning that it is inordinately or unusually hot. So.
And who do we have in our guest chat window this morning, Chris?
Well, we have Brian Washburn joining us once again.
That's right.
He's back for another episode.
Woohoo!
Previously on Instructional Designers and Offices Drinking Coffee. Anyway. Brian, let's get you to go ahead and give yourself an introduction to our folks, because even though you have been with us before, maybe not everybody caught that episode.
Yeah. Awesome. So first of all, how is the sound? Is it sounding
actually,
okay?
Yeah, it's working. It's a relief. So far, so good. Yeah.
That was a fun way to start a Wednesday. So hello, everyone. I'm Brian Washburn. I am with this company called Endurance Learning, and I have been in the world of training and development for about 20 years. Now I run my own company, Endurance Learning, so all that hard work paid off and I get to be my own boss to some degree. And I have a book that just came out called What's Your Formula? And it's based on this periodic table of elements, which we will be talking about today. Hard copies are actually in hand finally, even though ATD, the publisher, has said that it won't be out until June 29th. Rumor has it that Amazon has shipped them, and so if you've ordered it, it should be in the mail. Beyond that, I've worked in the world of learning development, as I said, mostly in the nonprofit space. And so I've spent most of my career working in the foster care system, working for an eye bank, so cornea transplants, working at the youth center, which is where I cut my teeth in instructional design, teaching GED classes. And so I've done kind of the range of lots of different training programs, whether it's instructor-led or e-learning, virtual, and just kind of job aids too. So
very cool.
That's a little bit about me.
Yeah. And that's a different background than a lot of our guests, often pretty focused on the corporate world. So that's kind of neat to have that that nonprofit background for sure. Yeah.
And it's really, so when I started this company, Endurance Learning, I started it with a friend of mine from my undergrad days. He came from the corporate side. I came from the nonprofit side. And it's really fun to see a mix of clients too, that we're working with. And so it's kind of neat to be able to bring some save the world or change the world types of things along with let's make some money too.
Very cool. Neat combination. Yeah.
Yeah.
So you've got this book, but let's maybe talk about the genesis of it. Like, where did it come from? How did you, you know, what prompted it? Where did it, what's its origin story?
Yeah. So, and it's funny. A few years ago, it was just a random Thursday, and I was out for lunch with my oldest child, who for some reason didn't have school that day. And we decided to have lunch at this place called the Lunchbox Laboratory here in Seattle. And they ordered corn dogs, and on their placemat was this periodic table of food elements, because it was a restaurant called the Lunchbox Laboratory, right? So it was kind of sciencey themed. And at one point I was like, can you pass me that tray that you have your corn dogs on? And I took a picture, and they're like, what are you doing, Dad? And I was like, I think it's really cool. We could do something like this with training. And so for the next few days when I would go hiking, when I was walking, when I was just sitting in my office, I was thinking, what would be some elements that would go into the learning space? And so I started coming up with all these ideas. I kicked some ideas around with my colleagues. And then we had a bunch of these element ideas. And then I was thinking, well, the periodic table is organized in different ways, right? So you have solids, you have gases, things like that. And I was thinking, well, what could be a metaphor? I mean, I think that's a really nice metaphor. What would be like a solid element for learning, or a gas-like element for learning? Like when oxygen gets sucked out of the room, we would know it, right? We don't think much about oxygen, but when it gets sucked out of the room, we would know it. What would be the equivalent in the world of learning and development? And I think that's things like adult learning or visual design, things like that. And so I had all these ideas. And so we created this periodic table. And then I was like, well, it probably needs some explanation. I mean, it makes sense to me, but oftentimes what's in my head doesn't really necessarily translate to what people see. And so I wrote a blog post about it. And then I pitched the idea to ATD to write an article in TD magazine. They're like, oh, I love this, right? This is a really creative idea. And then I was in DC for spring break and I was meeting with the editor who helped me put the article together. And I said, you know, there's a lot more to be said about each of these elements and how they can be combined. And so how do we kind of, what would you think about expanding this, maybe even turning this into, you know, a book? And the editor got really excited about it. The folks at ATD were great about this and helped me through it. And then, you know, a year and a half later, you know, it's up on Amazon. So that's been kind of the process and the journey. And that was the genesis of it was corn dogs.
That's also unique to me. Most of our guests don't have corn dogs
in their stories. Yeah.
Not gonna lie, I'm Canadian, so I'm not 100% sure what a corn dog is.
Yeah.
You're kidding. Well, that's okay. I didn't know what poutine was, poutine.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'll give you the corn dog, but come on, it's a corn dog.
I think it's what we call pogos here, right? It's a hot dog with like batter around it. Is that what you're talking about? Yep. Yeah.
And it's on a stick.
Yeah. So yeah. We call them pogos here. Maybe that's because that's a brand name, but anyway. Mm. Yeah, Ed's keeping me up to date. Pogo, for sure. Yeah, there we go.
A lot of Canadians in the house today.
Yep. Well, it is something that I hear, you know, on shows that are made in America and corn dogs. And you're going, okay, it must have a hot dog involved somehow. But after that, it's a cultural reference. Yep. It's an inside joke.
I'll remember from now on when I say corn dog to say / pogo.
Yeah, we go.
And be inclusive, absolutely.
You got to be inclusive, for sure. So, all right. So you got this periodic table of learning elements. And one of the things that I thought was really interesting when I was going through the early edition of your book was how you broke it up. And you organized them and sorted them into different categories. Maybe that's a good place to start. Or I don't know, you've probably been practicing teaching and figuring out a way, the easiest way to explain it to people and show it to people. So I'll let you run with that. But I liked the categories idea, I guess is what I'm trying to say.
Yeah. And I just dropped, so in the chat, I just dropped a link to, so that if people wanted to see here too, but if people wanted to get a chance to see it, and actually I'm happy to share my screen just real quick.
Sure.
So that I can just kind of, people can kind of see what this looks like. So it says I'm screen sharing. So can people see my screen? Can you see my screen? Okay, perfect. Yep. So this idea of different categories of elements, right? So a periodic table, the notion of it is one way to classify little bits, right? In the world of science, the physical world, right? You have these small bits that can be combined and make up bigger things, right? You have hydrogen, you have oxygen, you combine two hydrogen, one oxygen, you have water. You have sodium, you have chlorine, you combine sodium and chlorine, you have table salt. So with this, the idea was, and you can take a look at the screen. So we have solid elements, which are kind of either physical or digital tools that you can use to put together training programs. You have those yellow elements, which are gas-like elements. I was talking about that earlier, where those are more like theories or concepts that you don't necessarily always think about. You don't necessarily see in a room, but when it's sucked out of the room, you would notice it immediately. We have the orange category is kind of a fun category, and we can dive a little bit more deeply into this one as we get talking. That's the radioactive elements. Those are elements that can be really powerful, right? So if you think of of radioactive materials. It can be really, really powerful. You have to handle them with care, though, because if you don't use them well, it can blow up. It can taint, the reputation of your training programs with some sort of radioactive sludge that's really tough to remove. So things like lecture, PowerPoint, smile sheets, data, games even, I think all of those can be classified as radioactive. And then we have on the right-hand side of the table, the blue elements, which are the liquid elements. So these are like practices that are kind of, they're fluid, and they can take the shape of the vessel in which they're poured. So if you think of the organization as the vessel, kind of strategies or practices like supervisor support or coaching, things like that, it may look different in different places, but it can really be kind of take the shape of the organization. It can be frozen into place or melted down and changed up. If you wanted to do that. And then at the bottom, we have the interactive elements, which are things like social media or other digital media in order to find ways to reach out to learners, whether it is in a formal sense or an informal sense. I mean, Twitter is where I got a ton of my the foundation of what I'm doing through tweet chats, through interactions, through thought with thought leaders that I never would have had a chance to interact with otherwise. And so I think that, it's kind of neat to be able to take a look at the vast array of elements. And this is not all inclusive. There's other things out there. People looked at it and said, well, where are the podcasts? Or where are some other things? And it's not meant to be all inclusive, but it's definitely meant to get people thinking as they're putting together training programs.
Very cool.
Go ahead, Chris.
I was just going to say, go ahead, Brent.
No, you go.
Okay, then. So I'm thinking about your metaphor then of water, combining two oxygen and a hydrogen, etc. But I don't think what I want to just double check. You're not suggesting that there's a simple kind of formulaic approach where you need one of these, though, right? We're not going to that extreme level of, I guess, of interpreting the metaphor.
Yeah, no. And the book itself is called What's Your Formula? Because it's asking you, right? Mm-hmm. So you can take a look at all of this. And sometimes when we get designing training, a lot of times we do what worked for us last time or what we're comfortable with or what we're in the habit of doing. And so the idea here is to put a visual and kind of just an easy visual in front of people, just to remind people there's a lot of different things we can be doing. Yeah. And part of what I think is really effective design is playing around, is experimenting. And sometimes those experiments blow up, right? Sometimes those experiments fail. But then it's a question of, what did we learn from that? And how do we move forward? And so, there's lots of examples I can give you about ways to combine some of, I'm looking over here because that's where my periodic table is, ways to combine some of these different elements. And I don't think that there's any one way that's the right way. There's probably some wrong ways. There's probably some things that you might want to avoid. But I think that really it's up to people, up to organizations, and individual designers. And the other thing about this is, and there's a chapter in the book about this, if you're designing but you're not delivering it, that's something else you need to take into account, right? Because when I design, and I've run into this problem, I oftentimes design for me. And when I have to design for somebody else, or somebody else is going to give it, they'll take a look at it and say, well, I can see you delivering this. There's no way I'd be able to deliver it, right? So that's something else to keep in mind when you're kind of figuring out, well, what's the right formula for this?
Yeah. What's the best way to start approaching it? Do you start with one of the categories first when you're experimenting? Like, let's say you have a hypothesis, right? And you want to start diving in and try to solve a business problem or a training need. Where is there any particular category that you start with first?
Yeah, it's really interesting. I mean, obviously the ones that are in yellow, so those gas-like elements are really, really important ones. And oftentimes, if you're going to put these together in scientific notation or as some sort of formula, right, you're going to want to probably have adult learning in all of the things you're doing. you're probably going to want to have learning objectives in all of the things you're doing. And that's oftentimes, you know, good instructional design starts with what's the need, what is it that we're trying to accomplish here, and what should people be able to do by the end of this? That's something else, is that a lot of times this this table can be used or is used for more formal learning experiences. So we're thinking, you know, instructor-led or even e-learning. That said, if when during the course of the needs assessment, you don't need a training, maybe it's just handouts that you want to do. Maybe it's, you know, supervisor support or coaching or mentoring that's going to get people where they need to go. And so that is, sometimes it's just standalone elements too, right? But yeah. Again, we want to try to make sure that people are thinking about the vast array of solutions, and it doesn't always have to be a formal formal learning solution. But back to your question, Brent, you know, where might you start? You know, it does. It starts with the learning objectives. It starts with instructional design. So probably in that yellow category. And then you try to figure out, okay, well, if this is what we're trying to accomplish, which of these other elements are going to do it? You know, do we need to bring in subject matter experts to help us out? And if so, do we need to put a lesson plan in place so that if they're going to be delivering something, there's some structure there? Do we want to try to bring gamification throughout this? Do we want to just put a game, so gamification and game, they're two different elements because they're two different things. Do we want to put a game in there? So starting with the yellow, there's a few specific yellow elements. We should probably bold those or call those out or put a box around those, right? Those might be the places to start.
Yeah, I was going to say, I'm glad you brought that up. And that's kind of the sort of roundabout way to answer this question was, you know, don't we always kind of need to be thinking about those yellow elements?
Right? Yeah.
They're always sort of part of it, but they may not be, at the forefront of what you're trying to design, right? Like maybe, for example, maybe gamification, that element is just baked into your learning management system.
Right.
And there's really nothing you need to do. It's just what, right? When they finish your blend of your current project you're thinking about, then that goes into that success or failure goes into the LMS, and then the gamification sits in there, and then everything else gets added up. So maybe you need to think about it and know that it's there, but it's not really what you're going to be building down the road with the particular project. So there's different ways to look at it like that, which is cool.
And those yellow elements, they're sneaky, right? They are, that's why they are gas-like elements. They're invisible.
But if they're not in the room, you know they're not there.
Yeah.
Cool. So what about to the left of the yellow elements? I'm colorblind, so I'm going to go with green. Am I correct?
It is correct. Okay. Yeah, and that was actually something that came up when we were putting the book together because the book's black and white. So they said, well, how could we do this? And so in the book, you'll see a table that kind of just has something at the bottom that says these are solid elements.
A little key.
Yeah. Okay. So, but this is those solid elements. So in those range from, you know, kind of analog, low-tech things, like flip chart, like Mr. Sketch Marker. So there's some fun elements in here too, right? So if you think of office supplies, oftentimes we don't necessarily think about those. I'm a big fan. If anybody's read my blog about Mr. Sketch Markers, I think that I have them right here at my desk at the ready anytime.
Come on, we know you just smell them all during the day. When you need a quick pick me up, fantastic
right.
Little sniffers. Yeah. Come on.
Great. So there's analog things like that that you'll see in there. But then there's also kind of tools and templates. If you go to the lesson plan, there's actually a template that we'll offer for that one. You know, Microsoft Word is a tool. And then you get into some more digital tools. And those are, and it's interesting, if we were to probably do this table again, maybe we'd kind of list them or give weight to the numbers from easiest to most difficult to use or things like that. Because when you start talking about audience response and live polling during a session, sometimes facilitators get uncomfortable with that. You have rapid authoring tools. And so obviously that's something that there's a range of those out there. You know that with Domino, right? There's screen recording tools. And then there's some that people are like, what is that? that, text tools. And so that those are, you know, what it sounds like, sending text messages to participants as a way to follow up, or as a way to prime the pump, or as a way to give them learning boosts at the end. And so there's a mix of different tools. Soapbox is another tool, you know, that you can use to create lesson plans really quickly. And so some of these are really common that people use lots often. Others of these are things that people may or may not use based on their comfort level. And some are things that people haven't heard of that they can explore, just kind of like new elements are emerging from time to time. Same thing with this table.
The Hadron Collider of the L&D world, producing new elements all the time.
That's right. Hopefully it doesn't produce a black hole that sucks us all in. Yes.
Well, I guess, you know what, that does bring up an interesting point. Are there any mixes of these elements that we should avoid that might be toxic, that we know already that if you put these two together, it's going to explode?
Well, and if you take a look at the radioactive elements, the more of those you combine without other things around them, the riskier your presentation becomes. And maybe it's not even risk, the poorer your presentation becomes if you don't have some of these other things around them, right? So if the first two that you'll see in the radioactive elements are lecture and PowerPoint. Those are the things that people complain about when they say, oh, I have to go to the training, and somebody else says, well, at least it's free pizza. It's because what they're used to is lecture and PowerPoint.
Yeah, I don't see free pizza on your chart anywhere.
You know, it's funny. So the original version, if you take a look at the TD Magazine article or the original blog post, there's snacks. Snacks is actually in radioactive elements because you can give, you know, sugary snacks that can like drain people, or you can give like healthy snacks to people. Like, really? That's so I took that out for the book because it wasn't quite as specific. But if you take a look at some of these, you know, so if you put lecture and PowerPoint and subject matter experts together, and then you throw in role play, just because, oh my gosh, that would be a nightmare, right? So the more of those you combine without some of these other things, without learning objectives, without instructional design, without, you know, a lesson plan, it becomes rougher and rougher.
Yeah. I was looking at the radioactive list, and the thought that occurred to me was, these are often the things that our clients, internal or external, say to us, this is what we need. You know, we need an e-learning, or we need training, or whatever. And it's an interesting metaphor because it's got to be handled with care.
Yeah.
But you do got to bring in some other elements to make sure that it's going to be a successful
process. Yeah. And I mean, even Cassie in the comments here is saying, you know, people say virtual could be radioactive. And I didn't put that in. It's a tool, right? So virtual meetings is a platform. She's absolutely right. It's radioactive because it's lecture and PowerPoint. People think, well, I'm not in person, so all I can do is put my PowerPoint up and then talk. But there's lots of things that you can do if you were to give it structure. I mean, there's lots of things you can do in person. Why can't we do a lot of that stuff, you know, virtually? And so why don't we bring some of these other things in there?
And that ties into that specific point, ties into one of the questions. In the question panel, can you talk about how virtual instructor-led technical training could be made more interactive? We have learners who do some components as e-learning before they come in class, which is a virtual class at the moment, but they struggle with, or the team that's asking the question here is struggling with the interactivity during the actual, you know, virtual session.
So. Yeah. So, and I'd love to hear in the comments, because I think there's other people who do this really, really well.
For sure. So, we've got some folks.
Yeah. Yep. Go ahead and comment. But, but, you know, what I've seen that's worked, excuse me, is giving some, again, going back to what are the learning objectives, what is it that people should be able to do, and how do we know that they're doing it? And so by asking people to turn on their cameras and show me that you can do it, I've actually seen that work really, really effectively, whether it is simply, you know, people going to their own whiteboard. I mean, if you take a look at what teachers have done over the past year, with their classes, they've been super effective. And I think that the L&D community has a lot to learn now. And teachers don't have that much control. I mean, when I take a look at my oldest child's Zoom meetings, it's a bunch of black boxes, right? Because they don't turn them on. When I look at my youngest, who goes to a different school, a private school, where they're required to turn on their cameras, everybody's doing stuff. And so I think that we can bring, and I know that some people don't have cameras, or I mean, even before this was happening, we were struggling with my camera doesn't work or my sound doesn't work. But I think there are ways to see if people are doing things by having them turn on their webcams. There are ways to have them share their screens if it's something technical where they're working on the computer. So they're putting people into small groups, I think, is another way. Right, it's not the technology, it's not breakout rooms, it's small group conversations like we would do in person. And so any of those things, now it's interesting, and those are all strategies, right? Those aren't even in this table. But I think that this table goes back to learning objectives, goes back to instructional design, goes back to having a lesson plan. Don't just open up PowerPoint and put together your session. You know, map it out. What is it that you're going to do for the first 5 minutes? How are you going to introduce people? With virtual, a lot of times you do need to spend a little bit more time in the beginning, getting people used to some of the interactivity and interaction tools. And so, you know, kind of mapping that out and making sure that's part of your lesson, making sure that people know how to use the polling, making sure that people can respond, making sure that people use the chat, having people write on the screen and whiteboard. So all of those things, getting people familiar with that, and then building that into the session, I think has been really helpful. I'm not sure if that is answering the question that people asked, and I see that there's a lot of other things happening in the chat.
Yeah. And a point that you started, you know, out with, and which Cassie has echoed in her own submission there in the chat, is it's about what do people need to do? What are the tasks or what are the things that they need to be able to demonstrate? Keeping in mind that training isn't about just information dumping. Well, it ends up too often being, but the real purpose of it is to give people, skills or tasks, et cetera. So focusing on that then tailors, you know, the stuff that you're going to do in a virtual, the activities, et cetera, in a virtual or a classroom or e-learning, all of those things. So,
you know, it's really interesting. And I think it's a conversation to have with whoever is requiring or asking for the training, because I've worked with a few clients recently where they said, we have 2 hours, or we have 4 hours, that, you know, the audience isn't going to put up with more than 4 hours. And when I said, well, this is what we can do virtually, and we're going to miss out on this stuff, and we're actually not going to be able to hit this objective because we can't see if people can do it or we're not having the conversations or whatever, they've come back and said, all right, why don't we do 2 4-hour sessions? So we can't do a full day virtually, but you know, we wanted to pack this up into 4 hours, but why don't we do 2 4-hour sessions, a part one and a part two? And so I think part of this is also educating folks and letting people know that if we want this to be effective and not just a waste of 4 hours, we might need another 4 hours, so that we can go through, we can kind of use the technology as we can. Now I'm getting way far away from the periodic table, but these are all strategies. And part of this is just the one of the things that actually isn't on here that perhaps should be is consulting. We also need to be consultants with the people that we're working with so that people know what they're getting when they ask for, you know, 2 hours or 1 hour or put a limit on things.
Mm-hmm. What's the most common mix, do you think?
That's a good question. I think that one of the things that I recently, I think that for, and I think that for different people, they're going to answer that differently. For me, my most common mix would be learning objectives, instructional design, lesson plan, and then go from there, right? And yeah. And the lesson plan is an interesting element because that's really for instructor-led training, whether you're in person or virtual. If you're doing e-learning, there's also a version of lesson plan. It's probably called storyboarding, but it's basically figuring out how to map things out, right? Before you actually put things into a final type of a product. And so making sure that there's a map to it. Those would be the three most common things that I use all the time. Now, that said, I'm totally ignoring adult learning and dialogue education. And so, you know, anything that we do, I think, to be effective, needs to bring in those principles of adult learning. And then dialogue education, which is element number 13 on the table, is something that perhaps not a lot of people have been exposed to. It really goes back into the world of education. And there's an educator named Jane Vella, who's turning 90 this month. And I had a chance to speak with her on my podcast. And she has so much energy, but she really kind of did all of this training all across the world with groups of, you know, from young and old, different cultures, and basically said, you know what, regardless of culture, regardless of context, regardless of situation, these are 12 principles that I've found to be effective anywhere. And so that's something that I'll bring a lot of times into what I'm doing too. Now you start to look at some of these other things and it's really case by case. So gamification, sometimes that's effective and sometimes that's a terrible idea. You know, mentoring, I think is, I worked with a client recently where they said, we need training. And then when we started poking around, we said, I don't think training is going to solve it. What you need is for some of the newer staff to really just be connected to some of the more experienced staff so that they can kind of figure a way ahead. And let's put some competencies together and they can, you know, have structured conversations around that. And so I think that it will depend, but for me, the most commonly used elements are 12, 13, 39, and 40, which is adult learning, dialogue education, learning objectives, and instructional design. And then I'll always use a lesson plan too.
Mm-hmm. We have a question, another question in the chat, probably a good place, because you've used the word map a couple of times here. But Lisa's asking in the chat, how would you use this with a process like action mapping? And I just did a quick dash to the website and looked, and I mean, in my mind, instructional design, number 40, action mapping is a great model for that process itself.
Yeah, and you know, I struggle a little bit just because sometimes terms are used differently. Mm-hmm. So action mapping, I'm not quite as familiar with the process. But when we're thinking of if I could just get a little bit more information about kind of what is meant with action mapping, that would be really helpful for me to answer that question. I want to come back to that one because I have a feeling I have an answer. But I just need a little bit more information about what we're talking about there.
Well, it's basically a model that Kathy Moore came up with a bit ago, but it kind of inverts the process that we normally, or we might have traditionally been taught. It's not disconnected necessarily with ADDIE, but essentially starts with the organization goals. What does the organization need to achieve? And then what do the individuals need to do to support that?
Yep.
And in order to do that, what kind of practice do they need? Mm-hmm. And then working back from that, what's the information that they need in order to do that practice? And it's a really great model for getting out of the rut of the SMEs dumping, here's the 47 pages in the PowerPoint that they need to know everything. It's a great model for working backwards to focus and avoiding, it's very you know, task or outcome, you know, focused in that way, rather than starting with all of the information in case you might have to know it someday.
Great. Thank you so much for kind of the, and I see people putting links. I'm like, I'd love to be looking at these links right now. I love that question because that question does turn kind of the conventional design process on its head. And so with that, obviously you always go back to what is the objective, and you're talking about the organizational objectives first. And similar to what I was just talking about, working with the client who said we need training, we took a step back and said, well, what does the organization need first? And then it went to mentoring, right? So if you take a look at the blue elements on the right hand side, those are those practices that can be put in place so that there can be support across the organization for anything else you're going to do. And then if it seems like and something else that's not on here that perhaps could be is something like competency modeling, because when you're taking a look at what does the organization need, well, do people know what they need to help the organization be effective? And so going to figuring that out, putting performance plans in place, and figuring out, okay, what are the gaps? What are the gaps between people? Okay, so maybe these people do need some formal training. So we'll go into whether it's instructor led. So that would be lesson planning, adult learning, things like that. If it's e-learning, then you have that and the radioactive elements, but you also have this rapid authoring tools. And then again, like I said, maybe it's not even training. Maybe it's something where the supervisors need to be trained in order to be able to give better support. And maybe it's the supervisors don't even know how to supervise because they were promoted from you know, individual contributors and didn't get any support. They're just really effective at their job. And so taking a look at, okay, well, we need to train the supervisor. So, and then there's kind of a loop with supervisor support. If you can't get supervisor support until the supervisors know what they're doing, then put some leadership training into place. And so I love that question because it starts with what does the organization need? And it's not always, okay, well, how do we design the training?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a great path. That model is a great way to disengage from the standard. Here's the information mm-hmm. that people need, as opposed to, and it helps with consulting processes as well, being able yep. to reframe that conversation.
Yep. So,
that's yeah. what I was going to say too, is that, I'm certain that there's people in the chat going, yeah, this is cute and all as a chart and it's really fun to put it all together, but I've been doing this for so long, you know, yeah, this is just, okay, I get it. Yeah, nice, you know, whatever. But the thing that strikes me is that we often go into those consulting situations, whether it's internal with internal stakeholders or with clients as consultants, and we just kind of assume that they know what we're talking about. And so I'm always looking for ways that I can help them understand, one, the complexities of the work that we do. It's not just magic. We don't just whip up e-learning. Oh, you know, yeah, you're good at domino, so you should just be able to whip up this e-learning, right? Just like that. It's super easy. Yeah. You know, so to be able to go through and have a conversation with your clients and your customers with in a fun way like this, and to say, okay, here's all of the things that we need to consider when we're going to help you build your solution. I think it kind of opens up their mind a little bit. It kind of shakes loose some of their preconceived notions and will help consultants especially, you know, get out there and to be able to show to people, listen, this is why, you know, the quote I gave you is you feel is so high. Well, here, you know, this is the conversation we need to have then, so you can see all the work that needs to go into this project for you.
So that- yeah. And when you think of people who've been doing this for a long time, right. And I struggled just even writing this book. I was like, well, there are so many smarter people out there that are writing really, really good stuff. I mean, Kathy Moore is an example, or Will Talheimer, or things like that. And one of the editors I was working with said, well, yeah, and there's a place for all those books, right? And there's also a place for a book that kind of skims the surface on lots of different concepts. And that's what this does. And so even if you've been in the field for years and years, think of the handouts that you do and what happens if you combine those with instructional design or your whole lesson plan, right? And so instead of just giving handouts, the example that's in the book is that we had this one session where we came up with a handout that changed the face of the entire training program because we were working with a client who said, you know, we want to train our people on a new service. And they're used to selling products, but we want them to sell this service now. They're very skeptical. And so how do you, that's a recipe for disaster for a training. If you want to train people who you already know don't like the idea. And so what we ended up doing was we put the idea on trial as part of the training. It was a half day training program. And when they walked in the room, they saw a handout at their desk, but it wasn't a conventional checklist self-assessment. It was a jury summons. And you know what, when you take a look at jury summons, they have a little questionnaire on it. And that was the same thing we did with this. And that handout changed the face of this entire training program just because it gave a totally different look and feel and set the stage. And then the rest of the training session, you know, the idea was on trial. The participants were the jurors. We were hopefully going to present a convincing case of why the service would actually benefit them and benefit the organization. We had videos of actors that played like the prosecution and the defense attorney. The facilitator played the role of the judge. But it was because of that idea of the handout that we had all of these other instructional design ideas, right? So even people who have been doing this for a long time you know, there's things that we can tighten up in our practice, whether it is the handouts we create or adding visual design to the PowerPoint slides we create, or just kind of giving documentation. Maybe people like to tell stories. We've worked with people who train and like to tell stories, and they've been in the industry for 40, 50 years, and they have these amazing stories and people love it. But nobody can replicate it, right? You can't get somebody new into that position and replicate the stories. So how do we document those using lesson plans? So I think there's lots of simple things in here that maybe get overlooked, especially by those of us who've been doing this for a long time, that can be put into what we're doing to help sharpen our craft or improve what we're doing. Mm-hmm.
Tim had a note a little bit here back in the chat referencing it, what you've put together as a fun resource. And that struck me, like, even if we're taking this into a client, it's not just a table and a Word doc and formal like that. There's a there's an element of surprise. If you were to put this in front of people, they'd go, oh, you know, et cetera. And that alone could probably help, you know, ease into conversations or breaks the formality of it, breaks down resistance, all those sorts of things, too.
Absolutely. I believe that's a neuroscience thing.
Absolutely. And the other point that Tim makes in that comment is that it helps to build a common language, right? Yeah. And it's really, I mean, one of the worst things that can happen in a project is if we have one, we're using a word one way and somebody else is using the word a different way. And so we think we're talking about the same thing, but we're not. And so being able to build that common language, I think is really helpful.
Mm-hmm. Finding that common ground is something that you have to figure out with your clients and your internal stakeholders for sure. But wait a second, I think I hear that funny guitar going.
Hey, listen, it's time to wrap up. Brent's giving us the hook. Brian, thanks so much for joining us today. Toss your contact info. I know you did a link to the book or the website earlier, but that, and even if, you know, if an Amazon link too. Cassie mentions in the chat earlier that she's actually got her copy already from Amazon, so that's brilliant. Thanks as well to everybody who's joined us here. The chat comments were fabulous. The questions were fabulous, as always. You guys are all rock stars. And we're going to dance on out of here, guys. Have a great rest of the week, and we'll see you next time.
Well, yes, we will, but we will also see you in the LinkedIn group that we have created that I would like to drop into the chat for you. And if you haven't joined us in the LinkedIn group for Idiotic, you should do that too, for sure.
We look forward to seeing everybody there too, as well as on Wednesday mornings. Indeed. And of course, all the other places you can find us on the audio podcast world, downloads and those sorts of things too, so... Thanks so much, Brian. We'll catch you next time. And thanks, everybody. Let's dance on out.
Let's do it. It's nice to see all those charts in there.
Oh. Brian, that's the massive, the biggest commitment to chair dancing I think we've seen a guest make, that whole spin around.
I'm in it to win it, guys.
Nice.
I love this.
Very good.
That's a great way to start.
Thanks so much, guys.